don't know, quit crying and get rich yourself. I mean, that's what made America so great, right? I mean, money's not the evil, right? Love of money, love of money.
Don't ask what your country can do for you. Ask what you individually can do for your country. Today, Cheryl, that's not a Democratic message.
Yeah, I hate executive orders. My thought was, what a tyrant. But look, you're touching a nerve with me right now, because Obamacare, what you just described, that has happened in my paycheck as well. Or you can take the best of what American founders gave us and just expand on that.
Of a short stop and now I'm winning like I'm Jeter. Steady through the rigor, now I'm getting bigger.
So my guest today went to college at Manhattanville College, an online opinion editor for the Washington Times, host of the podcast Bold and Blunt, author of The Devil in D.C., and the one I'm reading right now is The Socialist, is that socialists don't sleep, why Christians must rise or America will fall. And interesting about her perspective about politics and culture from a Christian conservative basis, and from what I just learned too as well, also a United States Army veteran and licensed private investigator. So welcome to the show here in the Seven Figure Squad YouTube channel, Cheryl Chumley. How are you?
I am great. And it is so great to be with you. Thank you very much for having me. It's an honor.
Excellent. So I want to go back, Cheryl. Let's go to New York. I'm just genuinely curious sometimes how people get to write about things that they write about and believe what they believe. What was your upbringing like? Was it more of a conservative type upbringing? Was it a more of a liberal upbringing? Did you like convert because you didn't like being liberal? Or what was that upbringing of your household as a young child?
Well, actually, it was opposite what I am now. I was raised mostly atheist and very liberal. I was raised in Massachusetts, which is still liberal loonland, right? And my parents raised me to believe that the church was a nice place where people go who want to meet nice people, but that the Bible was just fairy tales. And so when I was in the Army, I actually had on my dog tags atheist listed for religious preference. So it was a while. It was in my 30s that I finally found Christ, but my upbringing was completely different from what I am now, which really works in my favor now because I see the other side. I understand the draw of atheism, and I understand where a lot of liberals are coming from, good and bad. So I think it just makes it stronger for God to use me in a communication way that works, that resonates best.
Amen to that. Cheryl, did you have siblings also that you grew up with, or did they also feel the same way?
I have one brother, and my whole family largely is still atheist. So that's something maybe your watchers can pray for them for me on my behalf. That would be great.
100%. I presume it makes for very interesting, holidays and things.
Yeah, we don't talk politics. We don't talk religion. We talk about the weather. We talk about, you know, pets and things like that. So, yeah.
I'm curious, what was your come to Jesus moment? What happened?
Well, it was kind of a slow progression. It was ultimately my husband who was kind of the one who brought me to Christ. But really, it was a thinking thing. It was a reasoning thing, which makes me kind of buck that whole idea where people say Christians are unthinking, because my come to Jesus was really, it was rational, it was reason. And it was basically one of the things I looked at was I picked up a leaf and I imagined going into a dark room with no clothes on, with nothing in the room and nothing in my hands, and make a leaf. And, you know, that's kind of the image of what God does, the power of God versus humans. And so that was one of the things that kind of brought me rationally to Christ.
Wow. Amazing. So when you are in the Army, and you had dog tags of atheist, you know, when I was in the military, the funny saying was, there's no such thing as an atheist in a foxhole, you know. And later on in this conversation, I'd love to get your perspective here, what's going on in Afghanistan. I literally just talked to a former Afghani interpreter who recognized me as he was hanging my TV on my wall in my house here in Dallas. He's like, I remember your face. I'm like, no way. How do you remember me? And I'm an Afghani interpreter. I'm like, get out of here. How do you remember faces? Okay, so we'll get into that here in a minute. But what was that like for you? Was your MOS, by the way, in the Army?
Well, that's funny, because it was a 63 hotel, which is a tank track repairer, right? And so when I got out of the military, I could not get a job to save my life in journalism. I tried everywhere. So what did I do? I became a diesel mechanic. And I was a mechanic on those big Mack trucks that you see on the road. I did that for 2-3 years. And I was also a mechanic on a car for a couple of years until I was able to finally get into journalism.
So you use your military benefits for that. Amen, sister. Yep. And so why journalism? I mean, how do you go from turning wrenches to now turning your brain and putting it on paper and using the power of the pen?
It was actually opposite. It was more like I had been young. When I was young, I had a skill in writing. It always came easy to me. But when I joined the military, because Michael Dukakis was governor at the time in Massachusetts, which meant no jobs, no matter where you looked. And so I looked at the military as possibly joining to be able to pay my bills, pay my student loans. And when I went in, I wanted to go in for journalism, but you had to join for 6 years. And I thought, well, I don't think I have 6 years worth it in me to respect authority that strongly. So I wanted something with a little smaller enlistment. And diesel mechanic gave you a 2-year option with, of course, you could stay in if you wanted, but the basic enlistment was 2 years plus 6 months of basic and AIT. And so I did that because I thought, I don't even know what a ratchet is, so let me learn something new.
Wow. So I gather there's a lot of steps leading up to your position now at the Washington Times. You know, how is it different from the Washington Times, the Washington Post? How different would you say from your perspective, the different publications?
Right. It's very different. There definitely is a liberal leaning press. And when I came up through the ranks, I didn't just land this job. I had 10, 15 years in local journalism and writing for free for a variety of websites. And this position, which is my dream job now, it was hard earned, but it gave me the ability to see what goes on in liberal secular newsrooms. And I can tell you with certainty that, first off, they don't think they're liberal. The liberals in the newsroom, they think that they are just being open-minded and trying to represent without bias all sides. And second, that they are very liberal and they are living in a bubble.
I didn't realize when I first started processing, because I didn't really start understanding politics until I say about 10 years ago. So I wasn't raised with politics. Our family immigrated here from the Philippines. And the Filipino culture, you know, it's family, it's everybody, it's loving, it's welcoming, it's come to the house, my house is your house. And so, which leans towards that type of disposition where it is very liberal. And, I remember growing up and there's different members of our family. I'm like, wow, okay, we have very interesting members of our family and you got to be loving on them and no judgment or nothing. And there's no base. And then I got into the Marine Corps and says, well, how do I vote? And all the Marines said, well, all Marines vote Republican. I'm like, why? Why? I don't know. I don't know the difference between Republican and Democrat. And so let's break this down from a basic 101 standpoint. Because a lot of our YouTube subscribers are just, they're so focused on their business, so focused on their finances. They don't understand the importance of how politics really affects their business and affects their finances. So if you were to describe in a nutshell, if you were to define conservative versus a liberal, how would you briefly unpack that?
Right. Well, nowadays it's quite different from what it was even just a few years ago under Bill Clinton, and it's decidedly different what it was under JFK, right? Mm. But basically, the way I look at the difference is conservatives are more individualists, and Democrats, liberals are more collectivists. And the danger of that schism is that we are leaning in America toward the collectivist side. You can see that really under the last year and a half of the coronavirus. And once America goes collectivist thinking and gets that in its heart, and more people than not think for the greater good versus for the individual, that's when America really cripples and crumbles from within.
Yeah, because you accept Christ not as a collective group, but you accept Christ as an individual. You accept him into your heart. I learned something new today. Amen to that. And so when we're looking at politics, you know, from a Christian perspective, because, you know, when I was coming up, I had part-time jobs as I launched my business. And one of them was a waiter bartender for Olive Garden and the E Club on base. and they always said, don't ever talk about politics. Don't ever talk about religion. You can talk about everything else. You can talk about, you know, marriages and everything else. But why is politics sometimes a topic, in your opinion, not widely embraced as much as it deeply affects all of our lives?
That's an interesting question, because when I was raised in Massachusetts and kind of had that old Yankee Miss Manners thing going, the etiquette. I actually loved to read etiquette books when I was growing up, and that was just part of the culture up there. And one of the things I also learned growing up was that in polite society, in regular company, you don't discuss religion and you don't discuss politics, because those are two issues that are near and dear to most people's hearts, but at the same time, they're very divisive. And so I think what we have going on now in America is we have lost the common courtesies of being able to exchange freely different ideas and respect the other person's position without feeling attacked and without feeling like we have to counterattack. And so what we have now are people who just, they don't know how to communicate, and they don't understand the common courtesies of, it's okay if you don't believe the same way I do. It doesn't mean life comes to an end. We can agree to disagree. And that notion is really gone.
Yeah. It's like you got to be shouted down or canceled in order, right? Or you got to come to my side.
Right.
When I'm thinking about, you know, JFK and his, you know, his famous speech, you know, don't ask what your country can do for you. Ask what you can do for your country. And I'm thinking, this is a Democrat message. This is a Democratic message. And everybody loved JFK. And again, don't ask what your country can do for you. Ask what you, individual, can do for your country. Today, Cheryl, that's not a Democratic message.
It's not.
Yeah.
Because the Democrats aren't Democrats any longer. Look, and you know this because you read my book, but I really go into this in my book. I want people to understand that the Democrat Party of today is not the Democrat Party that your parents voted for. It's not that same old blue collar, working class, for the little guy type of party. It's not even for the unions and so forth, the working class that way. It's for Marxism. It's for collectivism. And it's actually more communist. When you break down the platforms of the Democrat Party, there is much that is aligned with the Communist Party and the Socialist Party, and not so much the Democrat Party of just 40, 50 years ago.
I want to reference here, just in your prologue of your book, the seeds of socialism and what that means. And if you're a faith-based believer here, I hope maybe in your life you will start to identify these seeds too as well. But it says here, the seeds of socialism are ignorance, entitlement, and victimhood mentalities, secularism, immorality, jealousies and frustrations born of lies, indoctrination of the greatest of government, and weakness of the individual. What a profound identification of what the seeds of socialism were. How did you come to understand that these were being planted in our school system and in our education system? So Cheryl, please unpack those seeds of socialism.
Well, the seeds of socialism, there are too many people in America that say socialism doesn't exist in America because they're Democrats, or they're Democrat socialists, or they're progressives. And the reason I came up with that idea, the seeds of socialism, is that's what we need to watch out for more, because it's not whether somebody is a card-carrying socialist, it's what that person represents. And far too often in America, we see the Democrat Party actually pressing for the exact same policies that socialists and communists would push, instead of what Democrats of 20, 30, 40 years ago would push. So it's actually the seeds of socialism. It's the cultural rot, the cultural Marxism that we need to be wary of, and not just somebody carrying a socialist party card.
So, for example, growing up, I'm quite naive. I'm quite naive when it comes to these type of things. I just want to be a good person. I just want to get along with people, right? You know, that's kind of like where a lot of people are at. What are some of the perspectives that we have to understand? Okay, if I'm looking at life through this lens, because obviously we're seeing now how important the elections are, based on how we've seen right now how the current President Biden has kind of turned things a lot around from when former President Trump was in office. So if I'm going to be smarter with my vote, how do I process, learn about myself, where I'm leaning, left, right, center? How do I process that?
Well, I find it interesting that you said that you were naive about this stuff, because when I was in college, if you had asked me to name who was on the Supreme Court or maybe who was even in the cabinet, I would have been clueless. I cared nothing about politics. But at the same time, I read books like Ayn Rand and I identified with her characters. Yeah. And at the same time, I call myself a Democrat because that's what my parents did. So I wouldn't get so hung up on names and affiliations and titles and tags and things like that, as I would recognizing what's important to you as an individual in life. And where I settled was I'm a Christian and I'm a conservative and I'm unapologetic about it. And I think it's that final thing, that third thing, that's the key, because there are so many Christians out there that are scared to speak up. And there are so many conservatives out there that vote Republican as a ticket, but don't realize that a lot of things they're actually voting for aren't so much conservative. So if you want a quick primer on what to do, read your Bible every day to get discernment, right? To apply God's word to what's going on today. But then read your Constitution and apply the Constitution's basic brief principles to what's going on. And that will be your filter. And things should be held to the standard of they're either free or not free. They're either constitutional or not constitutional, not Republican versus Democrat.
Yeah, gotcha. And how funny how this little mask thing has become a virtue of whether or not you're right or left.
I hate the mask.
Right. Well, yes. your last podcast there, the doctor is discussing how the coronavirus is small enough to get through the masks anyway. So the mask. Right. It's
the death of critical thinking. And it drives me nuts that smart people will wear 1, 2, 3 face masks and plastic shields and goggles and God knows what else. But come on, think about it.
Yep. My son and at the time, he was 9 years old, but we got coronavirus last year at the same time. We got over the symptoms in 3 days. Our niece just got over the fever in a day. And so, of course, there's people out there, sadly, that have passed away from other complicating issues too, as well, that compound the factors of what COVID-19 can do to you. But when we're looking at the most pressing issues facing Christians in America today, I got a laundry list here. I'd love your quick, jabs at the pressing issues, your opinions on it. And so I got a punch list here I'd like to go through.
Sure.
What was your thoughts as soon as you saw President Biden sign all these executive orders the first 24 hours in office?
Yeah, I hate executive orders. My thought was, what a tyrant. But look, I'm consistent with this. I hate executive orders even when Donald Trump did it, just because I can understand why Donald Trump signed executive orders, because he had Republican control of the House and Senate, and it was his own Republicans who were fighting his agenda. If you go back in time, fact check that, you'll find it's true. So Donald Trump, in order to realize campaign promises that he made, he started doing executive orders. I still hate it. They have no business being in American politics, aside from just calling for cabinet members and calling for cabinet executives to report to the president on how things are going.
Gotcha. Your thoughts on the Keystone pipeline being shut down?
Yeah, that was just a loss. That was just a ding of capitalism. That just Joe Biden shut down a free market project that would have given tens of thousands of American citizens good paying jobs. And in return, he promised taxpayer subsidized projects to develop green energy that we already know isn't sustainable.
Which was my next one. What's your belief? Is this right now complete government takeover of energy, the infrastructure bill? What do you think about that?
Yeah, that's just socialism, pure and simple. And what bothers me most is the redefining of the word infrastructure. And because to me, this is a big example of how socialism seeps into society, into politics. It starts with the rhetoric, the changing of a definition. You know, infrastructure to most people, to most common, sensible thinking people, are bridges, roads, things like that, right? And we're all for that, even Republicans. So Republicans who signed on to that bill to develop develop and maintain those projects, okay, that's their job. They're doing what they were elected to do. But the redefining of infrastructure to talk about people and daycare and college, it's ridiculous. And that's actually how Marxists work.
Wow. We're talking about free speech being taken away. I think even yourself, either your profile or one of the articles that you wrote actually got delisted or removed on LinkedIn. What's your feelings about free speech now starting to be eroded and taken away?
Not just starting. I mean, we're on a downslide, and it's to the point now where even some Democrats, I think, are having a little buyer's remorse about not standing up for some Republicans and conservatives who were deplatformed early on. For instance, Alex Jones. You can disagree with Alex Jones till the cows come home, but you should be on the side of him being allowed to exercise his free speech. And honestly, if your viewpoints can't stand up to the scrutiny of someone else's speech, then your viewpoints aren't very strong. I love to have Democrats attack me because, first off, it makes me think, well, maybe they have a point. Usually they don't, but then it ends up strengthening my own viewpoint. And that's how free speech is supposed to work.
Exactly. That's why you have debate. You know, you have to have one side, you know, the process of just me being an entrepreneur. When I'm in a pitch, if I'm pitching my product, my service, my idea, my concept, so therefore I can acquire customers or investors, some people tell me no. And I'm like, why? They have a point. I've got to improve. I suck right now. How do I become different? How do I make myself very clear, right?
Right. If I suck at something, I want to know why. Don't just say I suck. Tell me why so I can fix it. And that's really how it should be, right?
And I think the most scariest thing about the freedom of speech on that downslope is if they can cancel the free speech of a former president of the United States of America, everybody's free game. Everybody's free game. Speaking of that, what about this whole cancel culture thing? We talked about it a little bit earlier. What's your initial thoughts on cancel culture, just canceling people out because they don't agree with them?
Yeah, you know, I had a podcast on this because there's been some thoughts thrown out there in the public to digest, right? That cancel culture is not a real thing, that it's really just people expressing their own opinions and opposing speech that they don't like. And if they oppose the speech by speaking out hatefully or even boycotting, that's their right. But here's the difference with cancel culture versus free speech. You and I right now are engaging in free speech, and maybe we'll stumble on something that we are at complete opposites of the spectrum on, right? But we will allow ourselves to express our speech and we'll agree to disagree and we'll go on about our days. Cancel culture would be when I disagree so much with something that you're saying, I just want to take down your business and I want to protest to your family and I want you to lose your job, or maybe I even want you to suffer bodily harm. That's the difference. It's motivation. It goes to the heart. It goes to the reason you are actually opposing something.
Wow. That's 100%. Equality Act. Thoughts on Equality Act?
Yeah. Well, the Equality Act, like so many things, is not about equality, right? It's more about pressing forward some sort of social reform, some sort of social agenda that the Democrats want to bring about. And they have a good chance because they hold all the power quarters right now on Capitol Hill. And I just implore people to read pieces of legislation that have these great sounding titles, because often what you will find, and Republicans do this too, just to be on notice, but often what you will find, the title is the complete opposite of what the actual text of the legislation brings forth.
Wow, so that's the game. That's the game of legislation and putting these bills in.
the
headline does not match the content. Wow.
Exactly.
Okay.
Yes.
Everybody's on notice now. If you're watching this, you know, unpack it and read the stuff that you are supporting your congressman to vote on. Imposing the $15 an hour minimum wage. What's your thoughts on that?
Yeah, on this, you know, out of all the issues that I opine on, this is probably the one that least gets me upset. But that's not to say it doesn't get me upset. I don't think the federal government has the right in a free market to impose minimum wages. That's just the basic principle. That being said, the federal government has stepped in and imposed a minimum wage. Why I don't like this sudden jump from, what was it, $7.25 an hour, $7.50 to $15 is what they're doing. The reasons that they're imposing this minimum wage or trying to is that they're taking these jobs that used to be high school jobs, right? They used to be for people who were entering the workforce for the first time and they needed experience. And they're turning these low-level jobs, basically, into something that you're supposed to raise a family on. Right. And that just defies logic. I think it disincentivizes people to actually go forward and sow the seeds of talents that God gave them at birth.
You know, Cheryl, I had three different jobs when I first started my business. So when I left the Marine Corps, I was a $7, $8 an hour lifeguard. I mean, we're not talking that far. We're talking about, 2001, 2002. And so I was a YMCA lifeguard, 5 to 8 o'clock in the morning, $8 an hour, just so I can read books and study for my exams in insurance industry. Yep. And then I'd pick up my kids and drop them off at school. I was a single father and was raising my kids. And then 10 o'clock, I have to show up at either Olive Garden. If I was a server or bartender at Olive Garden, I'd be working at Jiffy Lube at $8 an hour, doing oil changes. But I never thought in a second, that these three jobs is what I would need to raise my family on.
Right.
These jobs were just the gap for me to pay initial bills until my business in the insurance industry would start to take off. I'd start to get some clientele, and the commissions and fees I would earn from selling insurance and doing that type of work would be now full-time career.
Yep.
But I never thought that these menial jobs that, you're right, were meant for high school and college level, entry level, was supposed to be my full-time job, even as a single father with custody of my kids, raising them. So it's technology. See, I think corporations have responded to technology, or with technology, to say, if we got to pay X amount of dollars for these employees, I mean, the biggest, fattest line item on a company's expense, budget is staff, is employees.
Right. But look at what we're losing in this country, though, by handing people $15 an hour and telling them that that's how they're going to raise their families. We're actually devaluing the struggle. I come from years and years of working menial jobs myself. I probably had 50 to 75 low paying jobs, from factories to retail to scooping out dog poop to babysitting. I mean, I've done it all. And I never imagined that this was going to be my life, but it was all part of the struggle, right? While I held in the back of my head the dreams that I wanted to accomplish in life, to get there, I worked hard. And so when you do realize your dream, I'm at my dream job right now, but if this had been handed to me when I was fresh out of college, mm-hmm. I wouldn't have valued it much. I would have thought I was entitled to it. So when you strip people from that hard times in life, you're also kind of stripping part of the accomplishment, the feelings, the self-esteem that teachers always talk about now, that children need, the self-esteem that feeds you in life.
Cheryl, if it was Cheryl in Manhattanville College in 2020 during this pandemic, and it says, Cheryl, don't do those dog poop scoop jobs and, whatever. Here's an unemployment check. Just stay unemployed. And because you're single, no kids, it's, was it $3,200 a month for unemployment, equivalent to $18 an hour? I mean, how would the Cheryl ever evolve into who you are today as a woman, as a journalist, working your dream job? How do you think you would have acted in 2020 at Manhattanville College with an unemployment check stipend given your way?
Well, I know how I would have acted, because when I was in college, I was pretty. So I had people that always wanted to pay for my stuff, right? When you're a pretty girl, guys always want to buy you stuff. And I didn't like that. I wanted to work for myself. I wanted to make my own money. So honestly, I would say that this must have been something that my parents raised in me, to hard work and so forth, self-sufficiency. But I've always been independent anyhow. And as far back as I can remember, my dream was to just work hard and have my own stuff, have my own things and do it myself. And I don't know, I think maybe more parents ought to harp on individualism with their children and tell them that hard work is the way to accomplish their dreams and not give them so much. Perhaps that's it.
Yeah. Sometimes, and by the way, as a father of five kids, I get it from my kids, and my kids are probably watching this right now, or their friends are watching this right now, but, you know, they're angry that, you know, they're living in a very nice neighborhood, and at 16 years old, I didn't get them a BMW, I didn't get them a Mercedes. Cheryl, I didn't even give them a car.
Good.
I said, if you didn't do this, this, and this, I'll do my part, but you got to do your part. Right. And so, you know, they got angry. I mean, I said, one of these days, you're going to understand why your dad did what he did. In the meantime, I'm a jerk.
They will, because I have four kids and two of them are adult and have moved on. And one is 19 and he's already planning for owning his own business. He's got a work skill. He works hard. He goes to school full time and they do appreciate it when they get older. They're thankful. They're thankful that you let them learn and do things on their own.
Yeah, I want to bring up another social program, Obamacare. You know, because I remember my health insurance premiums went from like $250 a month and it skyrocketed to $1,450 a month.
Yeah.
And I'm like, Obamacare, now I got to fork out another $1,200 a month for Obamacare. And a few years ago, you said, you know, with your husband, there on the news, if my husband was waiting to get on Obamacare and getting the private care that he needed, he would have sadly passed away because I think he had a heart attack, your husband.
Oh yeah, he had everything. So, but his medical bills exceeded $1 million, and that came from the nurse actually at the hospital. She said that if they had to use Obamacare, he would have been pushed to the side because of his age and because of all the medical issues that he had, and he wouldn't have been given the top line care because at the time we had two private insurers. I kept one through my company, and he had one through his company, so we were paying top dollar for premium health insurance. And that's why he got the best of the best. But look, you're touching a nerve with me right now because Obamacare, what you just described, that has happened in my paycheck as well. And I just recently went to the doctor, paid a $60 copay for a visit, and then got zapped with all the charges that the doctor did in the office. And it's like, I was on the phone with my insurance company saying, what's the point of having health insurance if I have to pay for everything after I go to the office anyhow? So this is Obamacare's world. This is where we're at in America.
Yeah, that's it. And, you know, and why this is important for many of the viewers on the 7 Fear Squad, if you've got a business, you've got things you got to run, responsibilities to take care of, and it's very difficult for you to take care of your family. I'm imagining if it was going to be to a complete socialist program with this old Bernie Sanders, you know, Medicare for all, I'm envisioning it like DMV. To go to get your registration tags, your driver's license, and okay, A23, okay, you're not gonna get your heart attack check out, you know, and it's just how that would be treated and how you feel like an assembly line. And now let me be the devil's advocate here, Cheryl. Well, oh my gosh, well it's because the rich people, they have access to healthcare and private healthcare and they have money for this and this and that. What would be your counterpoint to that argument?
I don't know, quit crying and get rich yourself. I mean, that's what made America so great, right? That you're allowed to in this country, that no matter what your circumstances are in life, whether you were born into wealth or born into poverty, whether you were born and you went on to an Ivy League education, or you had to work, 20 hours a day to put yourself through a second tier school. So what? You have opportunity in this country. And I do not like this trend in America now to attack the rich for their evil sin of being rich and successful. And if they happen to be, greedy and immoral and so forth, you know what? That's God's domain to deal with them. That's not yours.
You know, capitalism, for a kid like me, came out the military and I still don't have a college degree. I got involved in the insurance industry. And Cheryl, it's funny, I was attempting to use my GI Bill, and the college professor, when my first orientation, goes, what are you coming to college for? I said, I want to make more money. Well, about a year and a half into it, I was starting to take his tax planning class because I was taking the certified financial planning curriculum. And at that point, I started my insurance career and I started making six figures. So, but I was saying, you know what? When I start, I'm going to finish, right? And so, Mr. Adams goes, so hey, he goes to me, So, Mr. Sapaula, how's that insurance thing you're doing? I'm like, I'm starting to make $8,000 to $10,000 a month. He goes, what? Yeah, and Cheryl, I was like, to me, that was oblivious because the people I started hanging around with over a year and a half were more wealthier. They're in the church. They're wealthier entrepreneurs. And that was just my level of expectation for myself because I started hanging around this type of performance-based type folks in the church. So I thought, and I'm the broke one amongst all of them, okay? And so he's like, you're making what? I'm like, making $8,000 to $10,000 a month. He goes, Mr. Spock, can I see you outside in the hallway? And all the students like, ooh, right? And he goes, listen, man, I'm sorry I gave you a hard time a year and a half ago, but listen, as a CPA, certified public accountant, as an adjunct professor here at this private university, just want to let you know, for me to you, man to man, you're making more money than me.
Oh, wow.
Right? And I said, wow. I said, Mr. Adams, are you trying to tell me to drop out of college? And says, no, but if the shoe fits.
You know, I mean, I think that's the great thing about America, that it doesn't matter your background. And but here's the thing that I think more Christians should jump aboard. This is kind of the other side of the coin. Going for money and everything and all that America and all that God offers on earth here is great. But in America, if you want to keep America free, you also have to be very charitable, because you as an individual, you're called on to care for the poor. And that does not mean petition your government to redistribute the wealth, take from Peter to give to Paul. It means you're supposed to reach in your own pockets and give to those. And that is not only your Christian duty, right? But it also helps keep America free, because the more individuals give, the less void there is for big government to come in and provide what individuals are supposed to give anyhow.
And if you didn't read the tax code lately, the IRS incentivizes you to be a giver, create tax deductions and all those things for those of you watching this. Of course, I want to know your thoughts, because I literally just got off the phone with a former Afghani interpreter. What are your thoughts on what's going on right now in Afghanistan?
I am so saddened by what's going on right now. Not only did we abandon the people of Afghanistan, right? We left them hanging. We basically screwed them over. But it's so sad to see people hanging on a cargo plane as it takes off in their desperate attempt to avoid what they know is coming, right? Which is like Saigon 2. And then you have Joe Biden coming out and blaming the Afghani people, for crying out loud. And I'm looking outward now. I'm looking at what's going to happen to the women and girls who, for the last more than a decade, have been raised in freedom. And now all of a sudden, overnight, they're going to be feeling some serious suffering from the anti-woman Taliban members. And so it's just a sad situation. And it just looks like America screws over its allies. It's not going to be good going forward in the future.
Yeah. And how do we build trust with our allies to say, if America says this, you know, and then, you know, the crazy part there is, you know, the challenge we have in terms of a world issue, my opinion here, my thoughts, is that, for example, China, there's a dictatorship. You know, I guess the benefit, if there is one, to communism is that you have a dictator for a long time. And perhaps they have a worldview and a world mission as a country to establish over however long they're gonna rule. Whereas America, it's flip-flopping every 4 years. Right. You know, you have a different opinion and different executive orders, you know, removing the orders of the former president. So how do we, as entrepreneurs, how do we, as faith-based believers, how do we, you say here, how should Christians, you know, stand up and rise up? And I put here in my notes, how should Christians stand up, speak up, and be proud of America and do our part to do something about it?
Right. Well, we need, founding fathers laid it out pretty well, that we need a moral people in order to have a limited government, in order to have a society that is rooted in individual liberties. Because, you know, moral people don't need government telling them what to do. We're guided by a heavenly creator and biblical principles. So we don't need government dictating to us. So when you go to vote, and if you're not voting, you're wrong already as a Christian, because your duty is not just to be in this world, be, you know, live in this world, but not of this world. But while you're in this world, you have to take part in the world, right? Otherwise, evil is going to flourish. That's where we're at now. Yes. So if you're not voting, you're the problem right now. So when you vote, you need to look for people who are speaking the constitutional message, the limited government message, not the entitlement message, not the critical race theory message, not the America apology tour message. You need to be very careful about listening to the people and not just listening to the party platforms, and do your own research. You can find out about issues online so easily nowadays. There's no need to take a politician at his or her word.
It's funny that you mentioned critical race, because our church here in Dallas, Elevate Life here in Frisco, believe it or not, they're doing a series on world issues in the church, which I think is pretty bold for the pastor's behalf, because a lot of churches don't want to talk about what's going on in the world today and how the Bible's lens and perspective how should we operate in today's world when it's becoming the divided states of America versus the United States of America? And they brought up critical race. Could you abbreviate and summarize what that line of that, what that theory is attempting to do in our school system and getting our kids to think and teachers to teach in our schools?
Well, critical race theory is injecting race into historical discussions about history and America's economy. So instead of talking about founding fathers and the principles that they brought forward, you talk about founding fathers as slave owners. And so that makes all the principles they brought forward inherently racist. And so if you carry that out to its logical ends, that means that we have to cripple the Constitution. So that's the difference. It's your focus. They inject race into all discussions.
Because I remember an interview you were doing, and they were taking down the monuments. Your argument was like, well, that's part of American history. As nasty as it was, why don't we create also the counterpoint of the correct heroes? So therefore, we can have a narrative that we can teach our kids. I said, instead of talking about the evil that happened in America, I would talk about the what happened after those monuments. So instead of tearing down, you build up a good monuments right after that. So therefore, there's two sides of the story that our children would understand. And I think that's what a lot of people forget about. Wouldn't you agree?
Yeah, build more. Well, why do you have to tear down monuments? Why do you have to tear down monuments of Robert E. Lee, right? Or George Washington? Why not build monuments of Frederick Douglass or some other historical, you know, Martin Luther King? We have those, of course, but you're not going to wipe out racism by tearing down evidence that you perceive as racist, which is usually wrong anyhow, because these people who want to tear down monuments are ignorant about truthful history. So really, we should be building up. We should be building more. We should be having discussions and not being afraid of what we find out during those discussions. Look, some founding fathers had slaves, right? That's a black dot on America's history. And America did have slavery. That is a black mark. But let's talk about it and see where we've learned and what we still offer as a nation and how we've grown and all the greatness America has to offer, aside from just focusing on those black marks.
As a devil's advocate, what do you think, Cheryl, when our founding fathers, if you talk about Thomas Jefferson, slave owner, he's got a big monument. George Washington, slave owner, first president of the United States. Do we tear down their monuments? Do you tear down the Declaration of Independence? Because they said in a document that all men are created equal. Now, do you think that when they were writing that, were they thinking about the slaves that they owned? That all men, that they considered black men, African slaves, men?
Well, look, Thomas Jefferson was the one who wanted to, you know, during the Western expansion, he wanted to make those territories slave free. And there were other states, there were other members, there were other people during the founding of the nation's government, some in the South, because their economy did depend primarily on slaves in certain farms and so forth, that disagreed. And so to move forward, slavery was part of this history's of this country. country's making. Not a huge part. It was a small part. But look, when I hear people harp on slavery and things like that, I think, well, what about women's rights, for crying out loud? Because if you look at the Constitution, Blacks got the right to vote before women did. So you can tear down and you can focus on, you know, the anger and the hate and the divisiveness, and you can continue that forward, or you can take the best of what American founders gave us and just expand on that. And I think the smart move here is to expand on America's exceptionalism, because it's carried by this spirit of freedom that knows no color, knows no race, knows no gender.
And if we're really following Christian guidelines and rules and values and principles, Jesus said to forgive. I mean, how hard is that? I mean, to forgive what has happened in our history, the nastiness that has happened, because I know what people want. People want justice. That's why they want, what do you call those checks? Reparations. They want some form of justice, which is something I think everybody, whichever part of the argument you are, you got to pray for, and you have to find a revelation and seek a revelation in that. Let me ask you this question. Because a lot of our viewers are also struggling with entrepreneurship and having to make money. I got to make $100,000 a year, $500,000. Not necessarily because I got to make that type of money, but that's what it takes to run a business these days. You need money for your business. You need money to live your life, to live in the neighborhood that you want, to have the access to the education you want for your children. But yet, a lot of believers feel guilty about making money, about being wealthy. What's your thoughts on that, Cheryl?
Well, why would you feel guilty unless you did something that, you know, you should feel guilty about? I mean, money's not the evil, right? Love of money, just like anything else, right? Too much love of food, for crying out loud, too much love of sex, too much. I mean, it's the overabundance. It's when you erect these false gods in your life that take the place of the true God, and all of a sudden that becomes your primary motivation in life. Look, when I was younger, I wanted money. That's it. I wanted to make a lot of money, and I wanted to be free and travel and not have to budget. And that was my primary motivation. And after becoming a Christian, that sort of went by the wayside. I still do like money, and I still prefer to have money versus not have money. But it's where your priorities lie. And if you look at the Bible, there are so many instances of God blessing financially. Solomon, David, there are plenty of examples in the Bible where God specifically granted and blessed with financial success. And so that tells me it's not a sin. It's in your priorities, right? That's all it's about.
Got it. Got it. I want to ask you here a few things too as well, and we'll wrap it up with this. Rank what Cheryl you think is most powerful. I got four things here. Rank what you think is most powerful right now in the United States of America. Okay? Here they are. In no particular order. Okay? Mainstream media, social media, Wall Street, government. Mainstream media, social media, Wall Street, government. Which more is powerful? Rank them. Give me your top four.
I'm going to say social media first is the most powerful.
Oh, wow.
What does that surprise you? I do have a reason for it. In the 3 seconds, I gave it critical thought.
Yeah, yeah. I was thinking the same thing too, but continue.
Okay. I'll say social media first. I'll say government, and then I'll say mainstream media, and then I'll say Wall Street.
Wow.
And the reason I said social media is that social media touches more people in America than government even, that most people are aware, right? More people take part in social media, get their news from social media, get their cultural ideas from social media, their trends. Everything is social media driven right now. And big tech has played into that and ramped it up to make sure their presence and their footprint is ever more expansive. So social media, congratulations to the leftists running it. They've achieved dominance when it comes to influence in America, I think.
Wow. Yeah, there's so much to that, because there's collectivism also, very, very much so, with inside social, because it's social. It's part of the collective group that you thought, and even though you individually might stand up and out amongst that that social group, that social media platform, there's still a collective aspect of it. You know, I'm still wrapping my mind around collectivism and understanding what that word collectivism, because, you know, serving a majority of our firm is multicultural. You know, a majority, 41% is Latino, 33% is African American. Those are predominant. And then we've got Caucasian, Pacific Islander is the next couple demographics. But so much so is the discussion of, I'm going to help my community. We need to vote and stand up for our community. Could you also get lost in that conversation too, as well, saying, you know, I'm after the aspect of serving my community, but I get lost with my individuality and my individual rights about that. Could there be a disconnect when it comes to that thinking from a Christian, Judeo-Christian principle?
That's such a great question, because look, this is what's taking place right now in America with the coronavirus, right? All the talk about the coronavirus and the need to take the vaccine and the need to get, you know, wear masks, face masks, and the need to participate in the vaccine passport. It's all about the greater good. And there are some Christians mixed in that group who agree with that, because they don't want their neighbors getting sick. They don't want their family members getting sick. So this is where the tipping point is, right? This is where the lines start to blend together. Individualism, which says, it's my body, I can do what I want, versus collectivism, which says, I ought to get this shot because I don't want everyone around me getting sick. So the tipping point to me, the line that we need to keep intact in place going forward, is who is doing the mandating here? If by individual choice, if you've done your research and you, you know, you've done your own research, your own critical thinking, your own decision making in this country about your health and welfare, and you decide that you want to take the shot, you want to get the vaccine, you want to wear the face mask, you want to carry a vaccine passport, that's well and good. And if you're doing it, your motivation is to protect others, that's well and good too. That's your choice. But the line is crossed when it's the government telling you you have to, because it's for the good of everybody else. And that's the line that we need to make sure does not get crossed. And it is right now. New York is doing it with the mandates and the vaccine passports. College campuses are doing it. And there is some pushback, but we need to fight hard on this point.
My mentor was scheduled to be at a meeting this Thursday, Friday. CEO of our agency, PHP agency, and he and 40 other people are about to have a meeting in New York. But they had to move the meeting to Connecticut because the conversation, the majority of them are Christian, but the question came up, they're going to require us to have a vaccine to sit in a New York restaurant. We don't want the uncomfortable conversation of, you have a vaccine, I have a vaccine, you can't be in the meeting, you can't be in the meeting. So let's just move the meeting to Connecticut. And I'm thinking to myself, if I'm a restaurateur, if I'm a hotel and I'm getting business from 40 people coming in and spending money in my hotel, my restaurant, I'm losing opportunities simply because the government mandated that everybody needs to get a vaccine in my state. And I'm losing money as an entrepreneur in that state.
Yep. So you have to vote those Nazis, or excuse me, you have to vote those tyrants out of office, right? You do. The sanest people to me over this last year and a half were those two New Jersey gym owners who refused to allow the local government bureaucrats to shut them down. They even tore the wood that was, nailed over their gym doors. Those two were the sanest people in America, and they should be the example even of Christians going forward.
You know, in your last chapter here of your book, scoffing those most equipped to save the dream. And I gather you're talking about the American dream. Right here, you have a bunch of bullet points here. Christians are well equipped to fight the evils of socialism and collectivism for a variety of reasons. And you've got quite a few reasons here. And point number one, Christians have a realistic, proper view of humankind as fallen, as sin-filled, as born into sin, and that causes a dependency on God, not government. Christians are trained on freedom from the get-go, that Jesus saves, that Jesus frees from bondage, that Jesus is a healer, protector, and savior, that through Jesus, even death cannot constrain, amen, hallelujah. The concept of freedom is inextricably woven into Christianity. You've got another 5 points here, and I suggest for those of you watching this, you get Cheryl's book and you read what these are, because you might fit into these things, and you're like saying, really, I'm equipped? And you didn't know you were equipped, but you are equipped, and that's why we want you to rise up. From a government involvement standpoint, Cheryl, I'll wrap up with this question. What can Christians do to be involved in, and I would say probably more accessibly, local government? How can we be more involved in local government to stand up and rise up, speak out, stand up, be proud of who we are, what we stand for, the values and principles of the American dream that we, in this home that we love? How can we get more involved?
Stop being frightened. Stop being afraid. Run for local offices. Run for your local boards of supervisors. Specifically, run for your local school boards. Run for these positions. Win these positions. And then when you hold these positions, speak out against the LGBTQ agenda. Speak out against critical race theory. Be that person that gets attacked and you're taking the daggers because you are making the correct fight. And trust me on this, more Americans are on your side bringing that message to local government than are not.
Do you think Trump is going to run here in 2024?
You know, he kind of intimated that he might run if the Republicans take back the House. So I kind of expect it. But Governor Ron DeSantis, if he runs, that would be just as good for me.
Yeah. I mean, the guy's a stud. thank God he was a kingmaker right there. Trump was a kingmaker with Ron DeSantis. But I'm living in a great state of Texas right now. We relocated from Illinois, and go figure, once I moved from Illinois, they raised the licensing fee for life insurance agents to get licensed. The taxes are raising. Property taxes are again skyrocketing through the roof in Illinois.
I'm in Virginia, so it doesn't get worse. In Virginia right now, aside from maybe New York.
Well, folks, you've been listening to Cheryl Chumley. Cheryl, where can people find more information about you, your work, and where can people find your podcast?
Thank you. At the Washington Times, just go to WashingtonTimes.com and look for my Bold and Blunt podcast or my hyperlinked name and subscribe to my newsletter, and you'll get them right to your email box. Thank you for that.
Sure. Cheryl, I've had a pleasure in this conversation. I hope we stay in touch. Yes. I think we have a company field trip to Washington, D.C. sometime in October, November. Perhaps that might be an opportunity for us to get our guys to get to be introduced to you and your work and what you're doing at the Washington Times.
That'd be awesome. We could do a live show.
Woo! Awesome. Folks, if you've been watching this, I'd love to know your thoughts, your comments, your questions, your feedback. Put it in the comment section below. If you haven't done so already, if you're watching this on Facebook, make sure you click like and follow our Facebook page, Money Smart Guy. If you're watching this on YouTube, make sure you click like. Subscribe and hit notifications to be notified the next time we upload our next episode. On behalf of Cheryl Chumley, I'm your Mighty Smart Guy. Don't forget to pick up her book, Socialists Don't Sleep. Till we meet again. Continue to live smart, continue to love smart, and be mighty smart today.